It's about tarsal tunnel syndrome. Thank you for the invitation once again. A topic which is not particularly close to my heart for various reasons, but I do believe that we tend to underdiagnose tarsal tunnel in our routine clinical practice. So I'm going to cover it quickly under these few headings. It was first described by Koppel in 1960 as an entrapment neuropathy of the posterior tibial nerve within the tarsal tunnel. A neuropathy of the main nerve or maybe one of the branches of the nerve, which is important to recognize if you're going to surgically release a tarsal tunnel. Now the anatomy, this is a flexor retinaculum. We all know the location, posterior lip of the tibia, anteriorly in the calcaneal tuberosity, converting the area into a tunnel through which pass the structures we are already aware of, the posterior tibial tendon, the flexor digitorum longus, flexor hallucis longus, and the tibial neurovascular bundle. The tibial nerve has So that is the attachment. This is a flexor retinaculum. This is the structures which pass through the tibial, through the tarsal tunnel. Now we have to be aware of the anatomic variations possible, specifically in relation to the tibial nerve and its branches. The nerve can branch proximal to the retinaculum, within the retinaculum, or sometimes even distal to the retinaculum. So when you are planning your release, you have to identify each and every branch of that nerve, and if you're going to clinically diagnose, then you should be aware of the fact that some of these branches can be arising distal to the retinaculum. The branches being the medial plantar, the lateral plantar, and the calcaneal branches. This is from the Roger Mons textbook. You can see that's the median tibial nerve. This is the medial plantar branch. This is the lateral branch, plantar branch. This is the first branch of the lateral plantar nerve, which is also called the Baxter's nerve. And these are the calcaneal branches, which can vary in number, which can also vary in their origin from the main tibial nerve, either proximal to the retinaculum, within the retinaculum, or some of these branches could be coming out from distal to the retinaculum. There are three sites, common sites of entrapment within the flexor retinaculum, particularly more proximal. Then it could be an isolated compression of the medial plantar nerve, not the main tibial nerve, where it crosses the abductor hallucis fascia. Or it could be a lateral plantar nerve or the first branch of the lateral plantar nerve where they cross the abductor hallucis fascia again. So be aware of the fact that it's not only the main tibial nerve, this could be only pressure on the branches which could be causing a plantar heel pain, which can be easily confused with plantar fasciitis. The etiology can be idiopathic, it can be traumatic. So if you, Dr. Rajiv Shah mentioned, in a mal united calcaneal fracture, you could have a prominent bones on the medial side could be causing pressure. So there are other trauma conditions which could present similarly. A space occupying lesion, ganglion, synovial cyst, varicose disease, exostosis, neural hemoma, accessory muscles, all of these can cause pressure on the nerves. The role of postural deformities in the etiology of tarsal tunnel is rather under-recognized probably. There are reports in literature. Budak reported nerve conduction studies in plano valgus subjects, and they reported abnormalities of nerve conduction in a majority of patients with plantar with flat foot. Danny Lau and Daniels reported effects of foot position and loads on tibial nerve function in 1998, and they said also reported that the function of tibial nerve was compromised in flat-footed patients. And Gold reported a combination of heel pain triad where the patient had plantar fasciitis, tibial tarsal tunnel syndrome, and posterior tibial tendon dysfunction as a combination. And then there could be an anomalous artery. The other factors which could contribute to etiology are, we are aware of these factors, so I'll just rush through them. The congenitally tight tarsal canal is probably very rare. So once you have a clinical presentation, a patient coming to you, you should elicit location of the pain. It's typically on the heel, on the plantar aspect of the foot. Patient can draw a variety of maps on the sole with his fingers, and it can be really confusing. Elicit the nature of the pain, paresthesia, dysesthesia, burning, patient can complain. Intensity of pain, aggravating and relieving factors will help you differentiate from other causes. The pain of plantar fasciitis typically is more worse after a period of rest. Compared to that, the pain of tarsal tunnel syndrome can be present even at rest in night, and after a period of exertion, pain becomes worse. Proximal radiation is possible. Clinical signs, Look, feel, percuss, and move. So what you look for is the standing posture of foot and ankle, deformities, muscle wastings, varicosities, or visible swelling of the tarsal tunnel for a specific lesion, and analyze the gait. Feel for the tarsal tunnel course of the nerve and any space occupying lesion. What your eyes can see and what you can feel with your fingers is a very important part of the diagnosis. Move the joints. There will be a loss of motion in coalitions, in trauma. Percuss for tunnel sign, the entire course of the nerve. Neurological examination is most of the times difficult to elicit, but there can be sensory defects, especially if you test them with the Sims-Weinstein monofilament. Motor examination for a tarsal tunnel syndrome is difficult to elicit intrinsic weakness, but there could be an atrophy of abductor hallucis and abductor digitiquinity. There are a few provocative tests described, like the tunnel sign, pressure over the tibial nerve on the tarsal tunnel area, a calf tourniquet, or a Kinoshita maneuver, which was described by Kinoshita, where you dorsiflex and externally rotate the foot. It will elicit the symptoms, will reproduce the symptoms of the patient. What are the investigations that you do? It depends on the patient to patient, but these are the routine tests that you will do. An X-ray will define the fractures, ultrasound, MR. Sometimes you do the nerve conduction if the suspicion is very strong. What is the role of ultrasonography? This was a paper published in which 17 patients were suspected tarsal tunnel syndrome underwent ultrasound, and out of 16 out of these 17 patients had a documented problem on the ultrasound. Very interesting. MRI. In 1903, this was a paper which was published, 35 patients with suspected tarsal tunnel syndrome, 88% had a demonstrable pathology on the MRI. And the most common, surprisingly, was the flexor tendon, FHL tenosynovitis, and the second most common was the varicosity. 21 of these patients had surgery, and out of these 21 patients, 19 had the confirmation of the diagnosis which was given by the MRI. Then you go on to the nerve conductions. We all know about the nerve conduction studies, the motor. There are three categories basically. Nerve conduction of the MPN and LPN, the amplitude and duration of the evoked potentials, and sensory conductions. Now there are ways to elicit data. I will not go into the details of how to analyze the data. But you will have a report which will suggest that there is a tarsal tunnel syndrome, then the suspicion becomes much stronger. Differential diagnosis, remote causes, disc lesions, internal causes or external causes are all to be looked into. So if you have a strong history, definite physical signs and a supportive diagnosis of an electrophysiological study, if you have all three, then you're okay with the diagnosis. Only two, then you do a careful monitoring, but if you have only one, you should be skeptical. What are the treatment options? You start with NSAIDs, tricyclic antidepressant, neurotropics, vitamin B6, a lot of other things. You do some orthotics, even you can give a steroid injection. But if you plan for surgery in an unrelieved patient where you tried conservative treatment for a sufficient period of time, then you can plan for surgery, and it can include only a space occupying lesion, a nerve release only, or resection of the space occupying lesion with a nerve release, or correction of the structural abnormalities if you think they are also contributing to the tarsal tunnel problems, depending on an individual patient. You must advise the patient about possible complications, and I have burned my fingers a couple of times. Patients can worsen their symptoms, and they can land up with a complex regional pain syndrome, which can become extremely difficult to treat. Curved incision behind the mid, just a few steps of surgery. You have to cauterize, and you have to have a bloodless feel. So I would typically use a tourniquet and a loop magnification. You release the flexor retinaculum, release the sheath of the posterior tibial nerve, and you trace and release all the branches of the tibial nerve, the medial plantar, the lateral plantar, till they enter the foot, and you excise the abductor hallucis fascia and release that as the nerves are entering the abductor hallucis fascia. Anatomical abnormalities with respect to nerve branches should be kept in mind, and we discussed that tourniquet must be released at the end of surgery. And if at the end of surgery you release the tourniquet and epineurium is not, and the nerve is not filling up with veins, then you must release the epineurium. Hemostasis is a must before closure, and you do not close the flexor retinaculum for obvious reasons, and immobilize the patient for 2 to 3 weeks. This is an incision for surgery. It goes right across towards the plantar aspect of the foot, where you can also do the abductor hallucis fascia release, and sometimes if you have the plantar fascia problems also, then release the plantar fascia. These are the nerve branches and the calcaneal branches which are released, and the plant going towards the abductor hallucis fascia release. The results of surgery are good. So there are approximately 91%, the literature says, good and improved results in 91% patients. Thank you.